Thank you. to men.
God has made everything beautiful in his time. Also, God has put eternity in your minds.
Two Yankee farmers were sitting at the back of the church. One was a little hard of hearing, and as the minister went on and on and on, he turned to his friend and asked, "What's he talking about?" The friend replied, "He don't say." So before I preach, I'd like to say something. Thank you. proper decorum has prevented me in the past from singing out her service to the church for praise, but now it's appropriate. For more than half a century, and to its credit, this church has had no expectation of a clergy spouse. I certainly had no expectation of that. But Mary's a kind person who, when she sees something needing to be done, just does it. She has a large heart, and so she sees much, and she does much. Mary has been a significant presence and help to this church and to me in my work as a senior minister. Part of your lives for so very long. it is a privilege that few are able to know. It has most often been joy. And our shared experiences, our interactions of heart and mind, have in so many ways made me who I am today. So from my heart of hearts, thank you. It was 26 years ago when, after a full decade as the associate minister, I applied to be the senior minister at First Church. And on the search committee, I felt confident was at least one member who was a significant supporter of mine. I assumed that when I was interviewed, he might throw me an easy question, like the Senate Democrats or Republicans always do for their own nominees. This was Bo Hume's undemanding question to me. Kendrick, would you please tell us, what is the meaning of life? Several names immediately swirled in my mind: Benedict Arnold, Montgomery, Brutus. But this was no time for revenge fantasies. What came out of my mouth, and so I have to thank Bo, had never been in my head, but it has profoundly affected my life ever since. I answered, the purpose of life is to remove the obstacles within us that get in the way of our receiving and giving love. The more I thought about this notion from both a theological and a psychological perspective, the more I liked it. And my confidence in its truth has only grown over the years. We all suffer from many such impediments. To eliminate the multiple roadblocks within our souls that prevent us from accepting and sharing love is the endeavor of a lifetime, an enterprise, a vocation we are called to diligently pursue. Because the central focus of our faith is love. A love that is both to be enjoyed and dispersed. Jesus made this inescapably evident when he responded to a trick question thrown to him. Jesus, which is the greatest commandment? What seemed like a brilliant trap question was answered immediately and with unmistakable clarity. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. You see, it boiled down to our capacity to give and to receive love. And Jesus goes on to announce, if you can do this, you will live. If you can do this, you will have found the kingdom of God. So let's now turn to that esteemed theological genius, Yogi Berra. He warns us, if you don't know where you're going, you're likely to end up someplace else.
Some religious types have suggested that creation
all need
is the result of an overflow of God's love.
And therefore, the whole point of existence is about communion with God and each other. We know that the first thing that God said was not good was to be alone. Relationships of equality and mutuality are at the heart of it all. If there be any doubt, we need only to remember the charge Jesus gave to his disciples at that Last Supper. This I command you, love one another as I have loved you. We follow Jesus, the embodiment of the love of God on earth, who embraced and healed and made each person know their specialness and their connectedness. And we want to better know this for ourselves and boldly share it with one another. The Apostle Paul likewise grasped the absolute centrality of love. If I speak in the tongues of angels and of men, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have all prophetic powers and understand all mysteries, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I might boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Now, Paul's rhetoric is so lofty that it's easy to miss the dire warning. If I don't have love, I'm a noisy gong. If I don't have love, I am nothing. If I don't have love, I gain nothing. To avoid this empty life, let us seek the support of the church and of each other. Let us pray to God all the time to increase our capacity to give and to receive love. There are many universal impediments to giving love, such as our individual and our cultural greed and fear. Through prayer and supportive community, we can minimize greed and fear's stranglehold upon us. As Eleanor Roosevelt put it, fear need not be our sovereign. And this is Paul's hope for us. He says, I pray that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, that you may be filled to the measure of all fullness of God. Sister Joan Delaplaine suggests how the love of Christ became so wide and high and deep. Jesus, she argues, believed that he was the beloved of God. And it is that truth that freed him up to be Jesus. It freed him up to eat with sinners, to touch lepers, and befriend women. He was free to disregard meaningless regulations and challenge the self-righteous. It made him free to cry out over a city that did not know the things that made for peace. This points to another stumbling block to our giving love, and that is failing to realize that each one of us, no matter who we are or where we are on life's journey, are God's special child. As God said to the burgeoning Jesus, God says to you and to me as well, you are my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. The more that we know this to be true, the more we can eschew our shame and our self-doubt that shuts us down from receiving love, and the less we will hold back defensively from generously offering our love. The love of God is a white light coming into us, a love that is refracted through our own particular personality of temperament and ability. And the outcome is the outpouring of our unique color of love. Our personality with compassion, our talents in action for others. In faith communities, we join together in a vast myriad of individual complementary hues so that the full spectrum of God's light can be experienced by the world. You are beloved. You are a necessary part of God's rainbow. Theologian Karl Rahner thinks along these same lines when he says, love is not an achievement which can be exactly defined. It is what every person becomes when he or she realizes his or her unique essence, something that is known only when it is done. So the call to love is generic to all of us, but how it is lived out is the direct result of our particular personality. Creation needs for each of us to manifest our love according to the unique person that we are. Young Anne Frank understood this, and words from her diary encourage us onward. She wrote, everyone has inside himself a piece of good news. The good news is that you really don't know how great you can be. how much you can love, how much you can accomplish, and what your potential is. How can you top that good news? So we work on bringing forth to the world our own good news when we work on increasing our capacity to receive and to give love. I remember officiating at a wedding for a friend of mine who had been divorced twice. His wife to be divorced once. They said that the one thing they wanted all their guests to know is that their love was an act of faith, a belief that they were worthy and right to receive and give love, that God meant them to have this blessing. Eric Fromm speaks to this when he says, love means to commit oneself without guarantee, to give oneself completely in the hope that our love will live in the loved person. Love is an act of faith, and whoever is of little faith is also of little love. Of course, we know our offering of love is risky. We might be rejected. We might feel foolish. We might be hurt. But Simone Bay helps give us courage to risk with this insight. She says, the workings of love are not smooth or suave or sedate. They are anguish, awkward, and incongruous. But above all, they have within them the seed of the splendor of victory. For if God is love, there can be even in the most awkward squeezing of himself through the narrow slits of our impoverishment, no point at which God's love is not omnivictorious. Knowing that we are beloved of God, that God is with us in our loving, that God is our loving, helps us to brave the obstacles that rise up in life to offer our love in more intimate and challenging ways. And in this way, we do God's work and grow as individuals and as a community of faith. As Augustine says, it is love that asks, that seeks, that knocks, that finds, and that is faithful to what it finds. I have found God's love embodied in this church and in you. I continue you to go about loving, loving boldly and in full color. So let me close my ministry at First Church with these words of St. Teresa of Avila. Make many acts of love, for they set the soul on fire and make it gentle. symbols that represent ministry in general, and there are symbols that are particular to our congregation. It's now time for me to return these back to you. The church committees, who are the final power and in whom responsibility is vested. In doing this, I want you to remember, and the whole church, that our religious forebears, the pilgrims, came here without a pastor. It was the lay people who organized and ran the whole enterprise here in America. Their spiritual leader for all those years was a deacon, Elder William Houston. So to the business committee, I return my keys. We've had a lot of key changes over the years. To the deacons, I give back the Bible, the New Revised. Our background is a background where scripture is the most important thing. Those early reformers yelled over and over again, only scripture would be our guide. So I return this back to you, the deacons. To the music committee, the steward, the hymn book. You all know the first hymn book was the Psalms. And I know I've spent a lot of time picking out a lot of hymns, some that you liked, some not so much. But I've spent a lot of time, and music is important because it has a way of entering the soul in a way that nothing else can. To the church council, Joe Catino, I give back our visions, and I'd like to take just a moment to read the first four visions from our 350th anniversary. Caring Support Fellowship. We are an active, loving, caring, Christ-centered church family with no one falling through the cracks. Interfaith Community Service. We are a Christian church family that believes all people are equal in the eyes of God. Therefore, we act on our commitment to break down barriers between all people and communities. Christian education. We are a Christian people who believe in an ongoing coordinated educational program for all age groups, using the creative talents of every church member of our church community in order to be better ministers. 4, welcoming and inclusion. We are a Christian people who invite all people to our fellowship, welcome, guide, and love all who come to our church, encourage family-led participation in the worship and activities of our church, and as a church family, because we are one in Christ, we celebrate diversity and support reconciliation. And then we had 4 more visions from 2003. But these still guide us and move us forward, and there will be new ones. Go. Pastoral care. Is Diane Hughes here? No? Diane? Go ahead. Comes from the shepherd. we shepherd our flock, we minister it, especially to those when you're in need. Now, you probably didn't know, because I didn't know either until this, that we have an official representing our pastoral care of you. And so I give that back to you guys. Bob is representing peace affirmation and justice. And I give back to you our open and affirming statement, which has defined us as a congregation of extravagant hospitality, a blessing to those who were estranged and making us a stronger church in love. And I'd like to read our open and affirming statement. In keeping with our vision of being a welcoming and inclusive congregation, and in concert with the General Synod of the Connecticut Conference of the United Church of Christ, we declare ourselves to be an open and affirming congregation made up of and welcoming people of any race, gender, age, nationality, economic circumstances, marital status, physical or mental ability, emotional condition, or sexual orientation. Therefore, we invite and welcome all people to join us in the journey of faith, covenanting together to be responsible to God and responsive to one another. As a community of God's people, we acknowledge our shortcomings and insensitivities as we endeavor to reach out to all who wish to join us in our pilgrimage, companioning and strengthening each other as we seek God's continuing revelation of truth and life. That was a tale from you, that revolution thing.
At this time, I ask you to turn in your bulletin to the service of farewell, the liturgy, and join with us. On July 1, 1977, Kendrick began his ministry with us at First Congregational Church of Guilford. Over these many years, he has been faithful to his call, opening his heart to us, sharing Christ's love with us, and encouraging us to be the light of the world.
I thank the First Congregational Church of Guilford, the members, friends, children, and staff for the love, kindness, and support you have shown me these 36 years. I ask your forgiveness for the mistakes that I have made. Please receive my gratitude for the ways you have accepted me, my leadership, and my gifts of the Spirit. As I leave, I carry with me all that I have learned from you, the love you have shared with me, and the lifetime of remarkable memories.
We receive your gratitude, offer our forgiveness, and give our blessings as we retire from our church ministry. Thank you for your 36 years among us.
Trust that God has been with us in our time together and is now with us in our party.
As we join in the vows of release, will those who are able please rise? Do you, the members, friends, children, and staff of First Congregational Church of Guilford, release Dr. Kendrick Norris from the duties of senior minister?
We do, with the love of God.
And do you offer your love, prayers, and support for his continued well-being and encouragement for his ministry as it unfolds in new ways?
We do, with the love of God.
Do you, Kendrick, release this congregation from turning to you and depending on you?
I do, with the help of God. I will always hold you in my prayers, but no longer in my responsibilities.
Do you offer your strong encouragement for the First Congregational Church of Guilford, its community, and its continued ministry?
I do, with the help of God.
May God bless these words spoken, words of thankfulness, forgiveness, and release. Thanks be to God.
On behalf of the Connecticut Conference and the United Church of Christ, I witness to these words spoken, words of thankfulness, forgiveness, and release. The member churches of our consociation and conference hold each of you in prayer. We pledge our support in the tradition signified in this service.
Thanks be to God.
Please remain standing as we join now in prayer. I'm going to ask all of you to join in this time of prayer and blessing. And the way we're going to do it is this. Kendrick and Mary are standing at about the third pew. I want those of you who are standing in the front to turn and face them. Those who are close to them, please move to the edge of your pew and place a hand on their shoulders. And will all of you reach forward and place your hand on the shoulders of those in front of you, so that everyone is touching someone who is touching someone who is touching Henry and Mary. And will those of you in the park please extend your hands forward so that we signify the way they Let us pray. O God, we give our thanks for the remembered times when we together have shared the life of faith. We thank you for the moments we have shared with Kendrick in worship, in learning, in service. We pray that Kendrick will be aware of your Spirit's guidance as he and Mary move into new chapters in their life and ministry. O God, whose everlasting love for all is trustworthy, help each of us to trust the future which rests in your care. This time we were together in your name, saw our laughter and tears, our hopes and disappointments. Guide us as we hold these cherished memories, but move now in new directions until that time when we come and are completely one with you and with each other. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. May be seated.
Kendrick and Mary, you want to come up and spend some time with us, please? just a little bit more. Okay. the executive board of the deacons just wanted to spend just that little bit more time. This has been a momentous year of both celebrating and remembering your incredible ministry here at First Church. We started in November with a celebratory night of remembrances and memories honoring your 35 years of ministry and the remarkable quilt signed by this congregation. We have been able to remember, relive, and relish the infinite ways that your ministry has shaped our lives. During the past few months, there have been special moments that you and Mary have had with deacons, deaconesses, the children on Children's Sunday with the garden bench, church members during teas and office visits, and countless other moments of appreciation, both small and large. Today, this congregation, First Congregational Church of Guilford, has another gift for you. This is but a small token of thanks for the huge gifts to us over these past 36 years. You have shared our lives. You have encouraged us to grow in our faith, in our ministries. You have christened us. You have confirmed us. You have married us. And you have buried us. You have nurtured us. You have empowered us. And you have inspired us. You are the cog in the wheel that makes this church the healthy, active, and vital faith community that it is today. It's so very difficult to show adequate appreciation for someone's life work that has affected so many along the way. There clearly are not enough words. So as you enter a new phase in your lives, we hope that you have some fun with our small token, that you will continue to be in our hearts, in our minds, for a very, very long time. And we pray that you find fulfillment and unexpected joys along the road ahead. Thank you, Mary and Kendrick. Thank you.
a blessing. May God bless you as you leave this place.
May God bless you
as you preach the good news.
May God bless you
as you share Christ's love.
May God bless you
until we meet again. Sisters and brothers, Kendrick and Mary, go now from this place knowing that you are upheld and surrounded by the love of God. Knowing that you, Kendrick and Mary, and the congregation that you have served so lovingly and faithfully for 36 years are being led into new futures by the promises of God, the presence of Christ Jesus, our risen Savior, and by the guidance of God's Holy Spirit. Amen.